Bibles up, wave them around, and make Jesus glad and the devil mad. And let's say this together. Say, Heavenly Father, I'm here by divine appointment, not by accident. I have ears to hear what the Spirit is telling me today. Holy Spirit, illuminate the word and give me understanding. I realize my faith can only go as high as my understanding of the word. And that's a function of the Holy Spirit. So I invite you to shed light, and I will become a doer of the word, not just a hearer. In Jesus' name. You know, because people that just hear the word and don't do it deceive themselves. Ephesians chapter 5, please. And another verse we can look at is Isaiah 60. Ephesians 5, verse 14. And Isaiah, the 60th chapter, will be our texts for today's message. I don't do sermons. A sermon is just something that, you know, some preacher, you know, works on and messes with and studies. And a message is something that comes from by revelation, comes from the Holy Ghost. And that's what I want to give you, messages from what God has to say. So most of these messages that I bring you are prophetic because they are from, they're hot off the press. And they have associated with them, they have demonstration. You know, I was talking to Brother Gary the other day. Oh, by the way, before I forget it, I wanted to say that Brother Gary is going to be here Sunday morning and Sunday night, March the 2nd, be ministering that day. And also, we're going to bring him back on April the 13th, which is the week before Easter and 2 days before the first blood moon is going to occur. And, you know, he came back with a message for the church to wake the church up, and that Jesus was coming soon. And before he came, he would be doing, you know, that we would see a spirit of prayer, a spirit of restoration, and an outburst of miracles. So I felt like this is the year of miracles, and I wanted a ministry. I can't think of anybody better that has more more demonstration with his preaching than Brother Gary. I mean, he had a bunch of young people. I think 15 young people came to the Lord on this trip to Memphis, Tennessee. And I mean, these teenagers came up weeping and shaking under the power of God. I said, it's because of the demonstration. They're tired of word. They're tired of hearing a big long-winded windbag full of facts and all. They want, I mean, they responded to the conviction of the Holy Ghost. The difference between demonstration and just preaching is just huge. And so I invite you to bring people. Now, the meeting on the 13th of April, we hadn't given his testimony here in several years. So we're going to do it upright. We're going to have cameras in the building. We're going to have multiple cameras. I'm going to do an open for him that he can use to male pastors that are wondering about him. There's still lots of pastors never heard of him. He's been around 47 years, and there's still lots of pastors never heard of him. And so I want to do an introduction. You know, every place he goes, they're amazed that he goes to church when he's at home. I mean, most preachers don't go to church at all. They go to church where they're preaching, and then they stay home. When they're home, they stay home. Not Brother Gary. He's here. When he's not traveling, he's here. And when he is traveling, he's listening to my messages. Every preacher needs to be fed. Anyway, I just, you know, be sure and invite people that you know that are sick or that need to get saved or whatever, because it's going to be powerful. So anyway, have you found it yet? Ephesians chapter 5, verse 14. Wherefore he saith, or it says, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. And then he's quoting here, wherefore it saith, and when he said, awake thou that sleepest, he's quoting Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60, verse 1, arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles, that is, the unsaved nations, shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising. So today I wanted to share a message entitled The Wake Up Call. The Wake Up Call. Paul is writing not to the unbelievers, he's writing to Christians. And he's saying, quoting Isaiah 60, he's saying, wake up, arise, wake up, and arise from the dead. Well, I thought they were saved. Well, you know, you can be saved and still be technically dead. The word dead does mean spiritual separation. The word dead can mean physical death. But another meaning in this context in the Greek, another meaning of the word dead means to be inactive as to doing the right thing. Inactive as to doing the right thing. It also means destitute of power. So it's time, according to Ephesians chapter 6, or 5 rather, it's time for the church to rise up, to wake up. Well, if that was true almost 2,000 years ago, how much more true is it right now? Because surely darkness has covered the earth and gross darkness the people. I mean, we see evidence of it every day. And this is the time for the church to rise up. This is the time for the church to rise and to wake up. In fact, it states plainly here that for the glory to manifest, the church has got to wake up. If the church isn't awakened, then there's no glory for the world to be drawn to. We're never going to have an end time ingathering of souls unless the glory of God comes on the church. And most people are just waiting on God to do something. Well, no, it's really up to us individually and collectively to wake up. Amen. And these things have been on my heart lately because, you know, I go through different times of anniversaries. And 15 years ago, on the 23rd of January, Brother Osteen, my spiritual father, went to heaven. And I got news that he had collapsed and been rushed to the hospital. They were working on him. The EMS unit was working on him, trying to revive him at the home. And this was 2 o'clock in the morning on that morning, the 23rd. And they rushed him to the hospital. And later on, they determined he was gone and so forth. But anyway, we were called in order for us to pray. Gladys got up out of bed. And man, she started hollering and praying in tongues loud and I mean, you know, and before I could even open my mouth to begin to intercede for him, the Holy Ghost said, Moses, my servant is dead. Now, therefore, arise. Therefore, wake up to your responsibility. He's gone. And I had an encounter with God in the fact that a mantle came upon me. I won't say it was Brother Osteen's mantle. I'm just saying my inheritance came upon me from his ministry and from my years of faithfulness and the years that I served him and helped him and traveled with him. There came an assignment because a preacher, once they leave, their assignment stays on the earth to be carried on. And most of the time it's divvied up among a lot of people. I mean, one person seldom gets everything. But anyway, getting back to that moment, I said, honey, it's too late, he's gone. And so then came the homegoing service, and it was really hard to go and be there. I just cried the whole time through. But I began to be alert to this experience that I had, and I began to think about Brother Hagin. Because besides Brother Osteen, Brother Hagin and Brother Roberts were the other two major influences in my life, especially Brother Hagin. I'd say more so than Brother Roberts in those years. Later on, Brother Roberts was, but in those years, Brother Hagin was. And so here it was now, by the time the homegoing service happened, and we're almost into February, and February is when the Winter Bible Seminar was going on. So Gladys and I, man, we signed up. We got our tickets, and we got a hotel, and we made plans to go. I'd never gone. The church, I seldom took off, and usually when I took off, I would go just to in between services. And what we had, we made a commitment to go all that week and miss Wednesday service. So we got there. It started Sunday night. We got there Monday night as soon as we could. The Hesters were there. And Frank was so gracious, he went and stood in line every day and waited at the door so he could go in and reserve us seats. And that's nice. I mean, it really was precious. And so we were there that he was at night, he was having Holy Ghost meetings. In the morning, he was teaching twice a day. In the morning, he taught on prayer. So here's Monday night. It was a Holy Ghost service, Tuesday morning. Now, I'm there because I felt in my spirit Brother Osteen went to heaven, and I felt it was his time also. He wasn't going to be with us much longer. I felt an alarm, or not an alarm, but an urgency to get myself under his hands, if by any means I might be able to have hands laid on me by Brother Hagin, which, you know, it's crazy. I mean, good night to 6,000 people in that big old church, and how in the world is he going to lay hands on me? But I don't know. I just had to go. So anyway, here Frank is stood in line that morning. We got great seats right there. And this was Rhema week. All the Rhema students from all over were there. Just, you know, big crowd on Tuesday morning, bigger than you'd normally see. And we were sitting close to the front, and he was teaching on prayer. And all of a sudden, he took off. He started laying. I think he laid hands on about a half a dozen people, and I was one of them. The Hesters ran. I mean, you know, I got what I came for. I said, okay, God, can I go home now? No. I got my load. And I'm talking about the wake-up call now. I'm talking about God waking us up to the time we're living in. And so then Tuesday night, it was a Holy Ghost meeting, and Brother Hagin got off into the Holy Ghost and got so overwhelmed, he just sat right down on the platform behind the pulpit. And he was a pretty large man, and it wasn't really comfortable for him to be sitting flat on the floor with his legs stuck out in front of him. So they went and lifted him up, put him in a chair, and he was that way for 30 to 45 minutes, and he was talking to God. And y'all were there, and you know, then he said, "If this is 1999, February of 1999, he said, 2000. Then he said, 2001. 2002. And he stopped, I think, as I recall. He didn't say 2003, but he actually went home to be with the Lord in September of 03. I heard him, God give him extra time. His time had been up, and God extended his time. So I did hear accurately. And it greatly encouraged me that I was at the right place at the right time, and that what I got was that there was a great purpose behind it. And about that time, I began to have prophetic insight into every year. I never did that before that point. I can't find anywhere where I said what's going to happen in 1988. I don't think I had a word for 1999, but I had a word for 2000, 2001, 2002, all the way. Every year God talks to me about the year and gives me a word about that year. I believe that's at least something that I got from Brother Hagin. Anyway, so now we're at the end of February, and there was a young preacher in town. I heard about him, and so I went to fellowship and listened to his ministry, and I knew the pastor, and so we all went out to eat afterwards at IHOP. And I mean, I didn't get to be. We were talking about Brother Osteen going to heaven, and we were talking about Brother Hagin and got an extension, and we just talked and exchanged and everything. And by the time Gladys and I got home, it was 3 o'clock on a Wednesday morning. Amen. Crawled in bed. And about 6 o'clock, just getting daylight, March the 1st, 1999, just getting daylight. And my eyes kind of flutter open. And as soon as my eyes opened up, I heard this voice, "Get up," just a mean military commanding voice that I wasn't familiar with. "Get up," first time. And I thought, "What?" "Get up," the second time. And I said, "Devil, I'm not getting up. I'm going to sleep. This is Wednesday. I've got church tonight. I need my rest. I've got to have more rest. Third time, get up. The devil didn't pay any attention to me. And then I thought, what if it's the Lord? And then the fear of God hit me. So I got up and stood at attention by the bed for a few moments. It was kind of cold, and finally I didn't hear anymore, so I crawled back in bed, covered up, pulled the covers over my head to get warm. And I said, Lord, what's this all about? He said, I want you to wake up the church. They're just like you. They're asleep in their beds with the covers pulled over their heads. And when I speak to them, they think it's the devil. Well, I guess I got my rebuke and my chastening. But see, I had to be awakened to something that I had been dead to. Are you following me? I mean, how can I wake anybody up if I'm asleep? I said, how can I wake anybody up if I'm asleep? And so I received a wake-up call. And you know what you do when you, in the natural, when you wake up, you look at the clock. You look for a clock. You want to know what time it is. Well, it wasn't very long till I found out what time it was. I realized that the thing that was lacking in my ministry was revelation about Israel and what God is doing on the earth and what a signpost Israel is for the last days. I mean, we're involved in world evangelism. I have traveled myself. I've preached like an evangelist for the lost. I have done pastors' conferences for the pastors, and in India and the Philippines. I mean, we're a regional center. God told us that in 1996. We had already bought property. We had obeyed God. People thought I was absolutely crazy to go buy 92.7 acres when we're just 3 years old and in a storefront over on 1960 for us to own 92 acres, buy it. I mean, people thought I was nuts. I'm acting on what God said. But now here, when Brother Osteen went to heaven and Brother Hagin is at the last of his ministry, and of course his last of his ministry was spent going to Rhema churches. He quit going to anybody but Rhema churches and graduates of Rhema Bible Training Center or Rhema Bible Institute for the purposes of waking them up to the Holy Ghost. They had gotten into this thing of the Word, the Word, the Word, the Word with no demonstration, no Holy Ghost. And he had to get them back to their roots because Brother Hagin wasn't just Word, Word, Word. He preached with demonstration. He patterned that. He manifested that to them, and they didn't take it with them in most cases. And I'm sad to say most of them didn't grab a hold of what he stuck around for. God gave him an extra period of time to get that done. He did his part, and I'm sorry to say most of the guys didn't do their part. Why, how do you know that? Well, because I've got friends that go preach in those churches. They're deader than a mackerel. One church Brother Gary went to, big Word of Faith church, preached just all that faith business, and I believe in faith, Word of Faith. We're Word of Faith around here, but we're Holy Ghost. You have to have both. Brother, the first night he asked, okay, all the Holy Ghost says all that have cancer, the entire front of the building filled up with people who had cancer in a Word of Faith church. Why? Because they don't lay hands on the sick. They don't give God an opportunity to move in the service. It's just, if you don't get it yourself, that's it. Well, God's got all kind of ways to get people blessed and healed. And one of those is the laying on of hands. I mean, for some reason, these people, they want an hour service. They don't want to go to a bunch of trouble. I knew one guy, I knew him very well. His idea about praying for the sick was have the church service for an hour, and then, hey, if anybody's sick, there'll be people down here to help you after the service. But you only have 15 minutes because we got another service. I mean, that's just like a leftover. That's like telling people, eh. No, we do it right in the beginning, right after worship. We do it right. And why should somebody sit through the service if they're hurting? Why should people sit through a service when they're tormented and they've got all kind of care? Why not open the altar and get them free? But anyway, I was awakened to the fact that Jesus is coming soon. Romans 13:11, it's high time for us to wake out of sleep, for our salvation is nearer than what we figured. Yeah, you get kind of dead to it if you've been brought up in churches that talk about the rapture all the time and talk about the coming of the Lord. And sometimes people just kind of get dead to it, and they don't want to hear it anymore because it's been used as a hammer. Well, you better get right with God. He could come at any moment. How many of you were raised in that Pentecostal or Baptist way where you had to toe the line? You know, if you didn't toe the line, you get it left behind. You don't do what pastor says, you're going to miss the rapture. No, that's not what it's about. But yet at the same time, he is coming soon. And why do we know? Israel is the signpost. Israel is the gigantic billboard on the highway. I mean, if you saw a billboard that says bridge out 5 miles, wouldn't you start looking for an exit? I tell you, we're looking for the exit. So right after that, I started tuning back into Billy Brim. You know, Billy, now Gladys has gone to all her meetings. I think she's only missed one in 15 years since it started. I'm talking about the Autumn Assembly. And I considered Billy the expert on Israel because she lived there a number of years and learned the language. And God gave her an assignment that's different than mine. God didn't give me an assignment about Israel except to know about it. Gave her an assignment to show God's love to the Jews. That's a different ministry and a different calling. And she gets criticized many times because of what she is just, she's obeying God. Amen. Well, those people are not saved. Well, I know they're not saved, and she knows they're not saved, but God told her to show Christ's love. Don't you think they deserve God's love when they've been shown God, in the name of Jesus and in the name of God, they've been murdered for 2,000 years and persecuted? And so she has and does. But she was talking about that time. She said 1999 is the year when everything changed. She had a whole teaching on it. It was very interesting. And there was a shift. Something had happened. And even the Jewish rabbis, the ones that study everything, you know, they're not saved again. But yet they do have certain revelations about their coming of their Messiah. So we have an overlap. And they're able to know certain things. And besides that, there's a lot of Jewish rabbis that are saved, that are in Israel, and you don't know about them because it's not ready for them to come out. If they did, they'd be murdered. They wouldn't last very long. Well, why don't they just go ahead and be martyred? Well, God's got a plan. Let's not be critical. But at any time in 1999. That was the year that, and I can't teach it. That's not my purpose this morning. It just was something that alerted me that I needed to press into that part of the ministry and begin to teach on that a little bit and begin to wake the people up as to Israel. And it's a big signpost. And of course, when you delve into that, you delve into politics, because there's no subject on earth that's more filled with the big lie than the subject of Israel. I had already taken a stand when Bill Clinton committed a sin in the Oval Office, and I stood up after the prayer breakfast when famous preachers got up and vouched for him that he had repented. I said, no, he's not repented. Well, pastor, that's being judgmental. Well, I can just look, if he had repented, he would have resigned his office. Instead, he lawyered up and fought the obvious. He committed perjury. And even if he didn't technically commit perjury, he lied to me, he lied to you, and he wouldn't admit it that he lied. Instead, he lawyered up and said, no, I didn't lie. It depends on what the meaning of is. And you're going to vouch for him, preacher? You're going to get on national television and people that are in our general camp and say, yes, he's a wonderful man. I vouch for him. I didn't vouch for him. I got up and I told people he hadn't repented and he deserves to leave office. And the people that could have sent him packing didn't have the courage because the Speaker of the House had committed adultery on his wife. Yes. Pastor, why do you get into this? Because lie after lie after lie is told about Israel, the big lie. They learn from Karl Marx. Make the lie huge and tell it over and over until people believe it. Global warming. Occupy Palestine. It's not Palestine, I got news for you. It's Israel. There's never been any such thing as Palestine. There is no Palestine. It's Israel. It's a big lie. So you have to get into the other things. You have to get into the economy. You have to get into the politics. You have to get into all this stuff because that's where all the lies are. Jesus said, be not deceived in the last days. So yeah, we're a regional center. And one of our mandates is to sound the wake-up call. Wake up. And quit pulling the cover over your head and acting like God, when God is speaking, and acting like it's a devil. I still have people think that I'm of the devil when I speak the truth in here. They get all mad and post on Facebook, oh, he's a hater. Well, no, I'm not a hater. I'm a lover. But I do hate sin. I'm like God. God hates it too. You know, I was about waking up. I was reading Luke 9:32 about the disciples. Peter, James, and John went up on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus. And that was the time when Moses and Elijah appeared to Jesus. And the Bible says in Luke 9:32, it doesn't say that in the other accounts in Matthew and Mark, but in Luke it says that the three disciples, Peter, James, and John, were heavy with sleep. And then when they were fully awake, they saw the glory of the Lord. We're never going to see the glory unless we're fully awake. Not just awake, fully awake. You see, I considered myself awake until God, with that military voice, that mean Lord of the armies of heaven voice, rebuked me and realized I wasn't fully awake. And so it's not enough just to kind of generally be awake. But we need to be fully awake. Are you following me this morning? And I've been thinking about these things now because it's the anniversary. It's the 15th anniversary of these things happening to me right now. We're in our 20th year. This is a momentous year according to the Holy Ghost. He's going to grant us signs and wonders and notable miracles. He's going to give us an opportunity to grow, not only in numbers, but grow and be more like Him in preparation for the greatest harvest this world has ever seen. I believe, you know, no one has lived in the last days like we have. We are in the crescendo, I guess I could say, or in the final stages of the Lord's return, and the pressure is the maximum. A lot of what you suffer is because the devil knows his time is short, number one. And number two, you happen to have landed in a church that's going to tell you the truth, number two. No matter who it separates us from and identifies us with. You know, I talk to my staff, I talk to my children, you know, and sometimes, you know, I don't want you to think that we're the only ones that have truth. We're not the only ones. There's lots of good churches. When I say lots, but there's lots more that are pathetic. Well, what do we do about it? Well, we have to wake them up. We're tasked with waking them up. And I don't know how to do it except to go ahead and preach like this and get it on the live stream. And then, you know, Brother Gary can go and wake some of them up. I think there's coming a time when I'm going to go and wake some of them up. And the day-to-day pastoring here will have to be delegated out. You have to get ready to let me go. I'm not saying it's going to be next week, but that's in our future as a church, as a ministry. Are you with me? So the wake-up call, I've got 1, 2, 3 things here just to make it simple. To be fully awake, 3 areas that you need to really be fully awake. Number one, awake to righteousness. 1 Corinthians 15. Paul was writing to the Corinthian church. He said, verse 34. He said, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. Isn't it interesting that you hardly hear anything like this preached anymore? That most churches are all about licking and slobbering over everyone, telling them how great they are and how much God loves them. Well, we know God loves us. And why? Because He died for us while we were yet sinners. I mean, that's kind of obvious. But God's love does not preclude His judgment. God's love does not preclude and our righteous standing with God, which is nothing but a gift that we can't grow in righteousness because it was a gift that came with the new birth. When you were born again, you were made acceptable to God. But that's the legal side. The vital side is we ought to live like righteous people. That's what he's telling the Corinthians, and that's what this age right now, the church now, needs this message. They don't need a bunch of overblown love, love, love. They need the requirements of our covenant to live right. John said, he that doeth righteousness is right, righteous. Doeth, not just speaketh. Doeth, amen. See, the legal, and I was preaching on this the other night, redemption is legal side. The legal side is Jesus is our righteousness. Isn't that correct? We celebrate that. We believe that. But there is a ditch, and I'll even call it a heresy, that's going around this greasy grace where it says that, you know, because Jesus died for our sins, we don't have to repent. We don't have to even worry about it. Oh, don't even worry about it. Oh, don't. In fact, you just get so far where you don't even have to confess your sin because 1 John 1:9 wasn't written to Christians. Oh, really? It wasn't? Oh, huh, you could have fooled me. I thought it was an epistle. See, this departure is a departure from all my fathers in the faith, and I'm not departing from the doctrine that Christians have to confess their sin when they mess up. Amen. You don't confess them to each other. You confess them to God and admit you've done wrong and turn around, repent from it, and then you don't keep doing it. Amen. Amen. People are watching this guy on television and having meetings in their homes, watching him on television, and yet... And not even going to church because they love that ear tickling, you're acceptable in every way. What they need to hear is they need to wake up to righteousness and what it means. Right standing with God is not dependent on works, but you prove that you're right with God by your works. Why don't you read the book of James? Faith without corresponding action is dead. And people that say, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Oh, I am. Well, I believe in confessing that, but you have to live it. And when you fall short, you've got to recognize it right now and get it right with God. And if you don't, that thing is on you and you're no longer in right standing with God. Or you mean you're going to go to hell? No, it means you're going to go to heaven early is what it means. It means that you're putting something in there. The devil's going to take advantage of you. You could, if you keep practicing sin, you could get to the place where your conscience is seared like a hot iron until you don't even recognize that you're saved. I mean, it's happened. It's called the sin unto death. It can be committed. It's committed by people who practice sin over and over and over until they get dead to it, and they finally give their salvation back. They say, Jesus, I don't need you. I don't want you. Get out. There are people that have done that. They're rare, but they exist. How could they do that? They get deceived. They lose the faith that was so dear to them at one point in their life, and they start listening to others. They start hanging around with the world. They start hanging around with atheists and ungodly people until they become convinced, you know what, I guess I've been wrong. I mean, I haven't died yet. See, they think just because God's judgment is restrained that he doesn't see it. I tell you, God hates sin. And if he didn't spare Israel, he won't spare you. That's what the book says, Jude. Why don't you read the book of Jude? Is this too hard? Because you know people that need to hear this. Some of them are your own children, or maybe your own parents, your own family, your brothers, your sisters. One great thing that Sister Billy taught me is that God has a side. And when I heard that, you know, have you ever heard truth and it just hits you right in the face? And, oh, my God. That made my knees weak. She just got up there and says, God has a side. You know how she does. I like her. God has a side. He's not neutral. And I've seen people try to be neutral. They have, there's a controversy going on, and they don't want to be part of it, so they just step back. And it's called moral equivalency, folks. It's exactly what's going on in Israel by this government. They said, well, the Palestinians are wrong, but so are the Jews. I mean, you know, and there's no equivalence there. The Jews haven't murdered innocent civilians. They saved their lives in the hospital. Don't start that. Well, it's the bully on the playground, but it's the victim. They're both at fault. Make them kiss and make... No! Why don't you punish the punk that's going around being the bully? Yeah. Kick him out of class. Why do you send the person that's bullied, to some sensitivity training? Moral equivalency is the denial that God has a side. It's a denial that there is a right and a wrong. Are you getting anything out of this today? I'm talking about awakening. Wake up. Wake up to righteousness. Wake up to what it means. God's love does not preclude his judgment. You know, God does love us, but he does love judgment. What is judgment? Holding people accountable. I mean, he loved me enough to rebuke me 15 years ago and get me back on track. I didn't know I was off track. I didn't intend to be off track. See, that's what the word will do if you give it first place in your life. It will chasten you. You're not really a legitimate child of God if you're not getting chastening out of the word of God. Some people don't, all they want are the blessing scriptures. All they want is the blessing. Oh, I want to go to the Bless Me Club today. Well, God is a blessing God, but there's a responsibility on our part. That's what I want you to wake up to. Are you getting anything out of this today? You know, Jesus, he said in Mark chapter 16, he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Tell them they're all included. Tell them I love every single one of them. All they have to do is just come to church and they're going to be just fine. Tell them to come as they are. Tell them just to come like you are. Just come right in the door and just... No, he didn't say that. He said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He required them to do something. And what is baptism? It is a symbol that the old man died and you are going to live in newness of life. So that when you come to God as a bank robber or a... skirt chaser or an alcoholic or a drug addict or a homosexual or whatever. When you're really saved and you get baptized, that stuff is off of you and you're a new creature and you live like a new creature. And that is who Jesus said was saved. They shall be saved from what? Hell. And he that believeth not shall go to heaven anyway, because I just love everyone. I don't want any. No, he said they're damned. They're condemned. Jesus said it. I didn't say it. There's not enough of the word for any conviction of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit convicts the world of sin. He doesn't convict the church of sin. He convicts the world of sin. And he only is able to convict the world of sin when he has free course in a service, when he has control of the pastor or the preacher's mouth. And utterance is coming forth out from the throne of God through the minister. But if it's a sermonette, then he hadn't got a place in there. There's nothing inspired about it. I tell you, the Holy Ghost is saying these things. Let's be fully awake. let's not join. That's why, I got to tell this one story that I just heard about. But Mark Barkley, I've known about him. I don't know him personally, but he's a pastor up in Michigan, I think. He's an ex-Marine. And you can tell it the way he preaches. I mean, you think I'm rough, you ought to hear Mark Barkley. Ruthie loved Mark Barkley. When Brother Osteen passed, she thought Mark Barkley was her pastor. That's how much she loved him. But anyway, Mark was at the Copeland Minister Convention last week, and he addressed the crowd and had a powerful message that I won't repeat, but it was powerful for ministers. And he told the story of going to a church to preach, and he went into the pastor's office, you know, before the service, you know, and the pastor was in there at his desk, and Mark walked in there, and he said, Pastor, he said, why do I smell pot in this office? I don't know if it was in Colorado or Washington. I really don't know. Might have been medical marijuana. I don't know if it's medical. Might have been synthetic. I don't know. Why do I smell pot in this office? And the guy looked up kind of sheepish. He says, oh, they all know that I smoke pot, especially before I go out to minister. He said, I get such revelation when I smoke pot right before the service. He said, you don't have revelation. You've got hallucination. You got guys like that preaching? They get high on drugs. The president gets up and says, oh, there's nothing wrong with marijuana. We know marijuana's not, it's a minor thing. Yeah. It's a gateway drug. It makes you stupid. It's proven to make you stupid, Mr. President. Maybe that's what's wrong. Maybe that's why you need a teleprompter. You smoked too much pot when you were a kid. Pastor, why don't you tell us what you really think? I'm all into truth. All right, let's be fully awake. Stay out of Colorado. I don't know about that secondhand smoke. I'm not sure about what that does to you, but anyway. All right, number two. I better move on here. Number two. Awake, be fully awake to your authority and your power. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 17 through 2:7. And we've talked about it many times, but Ephesians, you know, the Ephesian prayer that Paul prayed over the church at Ephesus, he prayed that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, would give unto them and unto us the spirit of wisdom and revelation or illumination in the knowledge of him. See, a lot of people just don't know God. They know tradition, but they don't really know God. They don't know his ways. They've heard these little truisms and these little statements of mercy and grace, and God is love, and God does have mercy. He has all those things, but you got to see the whole God. You got to know God for who he really is, and he is not a God that is going to leave off accountability with those he's given authority to. So you have to know God. He doesn't talk about the power until he talks about God himself. You got to know God. The eyes of your understanding be enlightened, illuminated, flooded with light, the Amplified says, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. And he is calling us to wake up, isn't he? And what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. He's got an inheritance in us that he's looking to receive from us. We talk about our inheritance. Listen, he's got an inheritance we're going to give back to him. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power which he wrought in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenlies, far above all principality, power, might, and dominion, and every name that is named, both in this age and that which is to come. And hath put all things under his feet. Where are the feet? They're in the body. And has given him to be the head over all things to his church, which is his body, the fullness of him which filleth all in all. And me and you hath he quickened. Yeah. Chapter 2, verse 1. And we were dead in trespasses and sins, but God, who is rich in mercy, and because of his great love wherewith he loved us, there it is, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are we saved. And raised us up together with him, and made us sit together with him in the heavenlies, so that in the ages to come he might demonstrate and show What is the riches of his grace and his covenant kindness toward us, or his favor toward us in Christ Jesus. This is the age that he wants to show it right now. Right now. His love is behind it, but his accountability. He wants us accountable. So we've got to be fully awake to our seating, which speaks of our authority, and the power, the dunamis, the resurrection power that he gives every believer. And the way we tap into that is receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You can't really get the fullness of the power without the baptism. How many churches even talk about the baptism? How many churches even allow anybody to pray in tongues out loud? We pray in tongues around here all the time. We don't worship tongues. We use it. It's our language. It's a supernatural language. You know, you go into most churches, they've got support groups for this and support. You know, I'm going to go to our grief support group. We're going to our cancer survivor support group. I'm going to go to my drug support group. You know, those, everybody that's came off of drugs, we have a little support. You know, we don't need any support groups. We need to walk in the power of God. We have the Holy One living on the inside. We don't need all these crutches and all this psychobabble. We've gotten away from the Word. Well, you know, God just knows and He cares. God knows. God knows all about it and He cares. Well, yeah, He does, but He gave you authority. He gave you power. He gave you the means to do something about what's going on. What do you relegate it all on Him for? Yeah, He knows. That's why He gave you this stuff. Got to wake up. We got to wake up. Wake somebody else up. Finally, we need to awake to Israel and God's covenant. Romans 11:25, powerful. I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness or hardness, in my margin, in part has happened to Israel until, everybody shout until.
Until.
Okay, say it five times, until. Until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. We're almost there. What do you mean by that statement? I believe there's going to come a day when the last Gentile on this earth is going to have been saved. God sees three groups of people on the earth: the Jews, the nations, and the Gentiles. The Jews, the nations, or the Gentiles, and the church. All right, the church is saved. They have a covenant with God, better covenant than Israel. Israel is not saved. They have a covenant. It's a land covenant. It's a physical covenant, but they do have a covenant. And God never did go back on that covenant. A lot of mainline denominations, all the Catholics, officially, the official position of the Catholic Church, including the new one that's so popular, is that God is through with Israel. That the church took its place. That's called replacement theology. It's a damnable heresy. They've always believed it. Pope Pius in World War II, basically, Hitler was a Catholic. He gave Hitler permission to kill the Jews. The Jesuits in the Spanish Inquisition killed millions of Jews back in Spain. They drove them out of Spain. And who was responsible? The Catholic Church. But see, Jewish people basically lump us all together. They think Christian, the Catholic, they don't draw any distinction between Baptist, Catholic, charismaniac, whatever. You know, we're all the same. So they're suspicious of us. And rightfully so. We've stabbed them in the back in the name of Jesus for 2,000 years. And so most Catholics, most mainline denominations, Protestants, Presbyterians, Lutherans, Methodists, they do not believe that Israel's covenant with God is active. They believe a lie. The traditions of men render the word of God to none effect. If I were in one of those denominations, I'd get out of there right away. Because God's about to stamp Ichabod if He hadn't already. These people are divesting themselves of investments in Israel. They're telling their stockbroker, I don't want anything to do with Israeli stocks. I mean, you know, if it wasn't for Israelis, we wouldn't even have a cell phone. I mean, they have so much technology they've invented over there, it's amazing. I mean, if God can be through with the Jews, he can be through with us, can he? I guess if God is through with the Jews, then he lied to Abraham and David, huh? Is God a liar? See, I mean, it doesn't take long to get right down to the truth of the matter. I don't understand. I mean, we have the same Bible. Why can't they read it like I read mine? I don't have an answer for that. The problem is they don't know God by his word. I grew up Catholic. I mean, the cornerstones of the Catholic faith, or if you want to call it a faith, is scripture and tradition equal. Scripture, anybody take the Baltimore Catechism when you're growing up? Some of you? Anybody remember scripture and tradition being the cornerstone of the Catholic Church? Well, that's exactly the word that God gave me to get me out of the Catholic Church after I got saved. I didn't get saved in the Catholic Church, but I got saved outside the Catholic Church. And then I was reading my Bible one day and I came across in the Gospels in Matthew, it says the traditions of men render the word of God to none effect. And boy, I mean, it hit me right in the face. And we'd been saved about 6 months and we were going to Lakewood about once a month and the Catholic Church the rest of the time. And I came in to Gladys. I said, honey, I've got two scriptures. He could there do no mighty work because of their unbelief. And the traditions of men render the word of God to none effect. These two verses spoke to me today. We need to get out of the Catholic Church. She said, well, it's about time. I said, when did you know? Well, about 6 months ago. And well, thank you very much. Praise God. I wouldn't have listened to her. Come on, husbands. You know you don't listen to your wives when they preach to you. You just tune them out. Let's be fully awake about Israel. And let's not believe the big lies. Joel 1:7 says, Israel is the fig tree. Jesus said, watch the fig tree and all the other trees in Luke 21. These are the greatest signs that Jesus is coming soon. In my generation, we've seen Israel become a nation. And Jews from all over the world. I mean, Jews from Ethiopia, Jews from Argentina, Jews, who knew there were any Jews in Argentina? I mean, they got Jews from every corner of the globe and they're being regathered like little homing pigeons. They don't even believe in God. They don't know God. They're not even good Jews. They're just Jews by skin. That's it. They don't have any knowledge. They don't keep the Jewish customs and yet they've remained separate. It's a miracle that they've remained separate, but yet don't know God. There's coming a time when God will deal with the Jews. And Paul said, all Israel shall be saved. Now, they're not going to be in the church. They have the privileges of the church. But they're going to be saved at some point in time, later, after we're gone. And we don't need to be wise in our own conceit. We don't need to look down our nose at Jewish people. We need to love them and pray for Israel. Amen. Are you getting anything out of this? So, we know that because of this sign that Jesus is coming soon. Amen. So let's not just wake up. Let's rise up. See, waking up and rising up. Arise. See, wake up and rise up and take our rightful place as believers in these last days.